Welcome back, and we're watching Government Policy and Your Business, and I'm your host, Ivor Blumenthal. I'm so pleased now to be joined in studio by Nerine Kahn. Nerine Kahn was CEO of the Commission for Conciliation, Mediation and Arbitration, better known as the CCMA, for 10 years, leaving in November 2015. Before that, she was Chief Director of Labor Relations in the Department of Labor, and she's most probably one of a handful of people in this country who understands what it takes to build bargaining councils and to keep them afloat while at the same time protecting the rights of individuals and businesses to both associate and to disassociate freely. She's currently CEO of the Employment Relations Exchange. Nerine, welcome to Government Policy and Your Business.
Thank you very much for having me, Ivor.
Thanks for joining me to discuss this issue. Now, you were Chief Director of Labor Relations before taking over the CCMA, so I guess it's not unfair to ask you why under your stewardship, and forgive me, I know it wasn't your stewardship in particular, but under your stewardship, bargaining councils, which often do not represent the majority of companies in an industry or in a sector, can be allowed to extend their agreements offered, entered into, and agreed to by a minority of business and trade union players to cover the majority of companies which could be considered to be non-parties, which quite frankly had nothing to do with either organized business or with the bargaining council itself. How does that become moral and ethical and tenable in this country?
You know, I think one must go back, you know, the over 20 years that the Labor Relations Act was negotiated, and the principles that were there at the time, I think maybe spoke to that, and they were valuable and they were considered the appropriate thing. You must start with the idea of majoritarianism. Majoritarianism was the key principle that drove all the negotiations around the 1995-1996 implementation of the Labor Relations Act in the post-apartheid South Africa.
What does that mean, though? Does that mean that if the parties to a bargaining council represent the majority of players in an industry or a sector, then there are justifiable grounds for an extension of a bargaining council?
That's exactly agreement. What it means. So the principle was then set into our law that basically the majority of parties in a bargaining council process would definitely need to have a majority in order to implement the relative agreements. And initially, I think that was easily achieved in the process. Then as time moved on, that's changed. So I think partly, I hear you under stewardship. The sections were that you had to meet 50% or more in each section. And certainly in the stewardship that I was in when I was in the Department of Labor, which was before 2006, on many, many occasions, nearly all the parties came in above or within striking distance, and I say that because let's talk about that as a principle and what happened in relation to that. Do I think now that that's probably relevant? I think the answer is no. I think we've seen even changes in the Labor Relations Act, which move away from the majoritarianism principle, but I'm not sure that the bargaining council principles have kept up with that idea in that context.
Do I have a defense as a non-party, in other words, as a company which has not joined an employer association which is party to the bargaining council? Do I have any kind of defense to say I don't want to be covered by a bargaining council agreement, even if the minister has extended that agreement to cover my kind of company?
Yes, the principle is that there's a process where you can apply for to be excluded from the process. You can be apply to have an exception to that process. I think that there are challenges around how that process operates, although there have been some amendments to the law of how that's implemented, and you can apply for an exemption from that agreement.
Just to check my understanding, it's the parties themselves who will make a decision as to whether or not I can be exempted.
Yes, that's certainly the case, and I think that's an area that needs to be looked at in the law, in the context of looking at the exemption, because yes, it is certain people, but again, you would have people you would hope would be seen as neutral and be able to apply their minds to both sides of the party's issues, especially in the challenges that you get in relation to small businesses. I would say that one of the issues that often arise, and I'm sure you would agree with me, is that you get the exemption, but the exemption's only for a short period of time. It's similar to applying for an exemption from a minimum wage requirement. There's a limit and a criteria in relation to that. And that's what happens there. So you would apply to your bargaining council and you would say, I want to be exempt, and you'd have to meet certain criteria in relation to that and give really good reasons for it. And based on that, then you could be given an exemption, but it would have a limited duration of time.
Nerine, finally, in this regard, Do you think the law should be changed as far as the extension of agreements to non-parties is concerned?
I certainly think it should be looked at, because I think the way our bargaining council systems are working have got huge challenges at the moment in different areas, especially given what we're seeing in the context of organised labour, organised business, the change of how they've operated and how they were set up 20 years ago and how they are now is actually different. And I think it should have a long, hard look at how it's operating.
And do you think those non-parties themselves, those non-parties should be involved in collectively trying to change that law?
I absolutely think they should. I think they should be given a voice at the table, and I think they should have the right to be heard. I think we're seeing a bit of a change in our labour relations environment on that, and I think sometimes we're not necessarily allowing everybody to be heard because they may not belong to all the right associations and principles in relation to that.
So there are tons of labour legislation and labour court precedents we'll have to be discussing on this programme, and I am very grateful to have access to people like Nerine Kahn, who speak from a platform of experience, from insight and from authority. Nerine, thank you for having joined me to unpack the impact of labour legislation on very often what is the unsuspecting business community, and we're certainly going to ask you to come back on this programme again.
I would love to, Ivor. Thank you for having me.
Thank you.